Optus boss Kelly Bayer-Rosmarin has sidestepped questions about her future while being grilled over a network outage that left millions of Australians without phone service. Live for us now from Canberra is Federal Politics reporter Fiona Willen. V, what did the telco CEO have to say?
Well, Jane, the Optus boss says this is not the time to focus on herself, but she has been firmly in the spotlight in Canberra today. So Kelly Bayer-Rosmarin left Parliament House surrounded by security after facing a pretty intense grilling that went for about 2 hours. Senators questioned her over many aspects of the network outage last Wednesday, which not only left millions of Optus customers without phone and internet, but it also affected the operations of many businesses and even brought trains to a standstill. Now, she opened with an apology and a promise to regain the trust of customers, but she avoided questions over whether or not she'll resign.
It is indisputable that on that day our performance was not acceptable, we let you down, and for that I am deeply sorry.
Is it your intention to resign?
Senator, I'm sure you can appreciate my entire focus has been on restoring the outage issue, and it has not been a time to be thinking about myself.
Now, one of the most serious consequences of the outage was that some customers were unable to make emergency calls. The CEO admitted 228 calls to 000 went unanswered, but says the company has conducted welfare checks on those people and confirmed that everyone is okay. While she acknowledged the seriousness of that issue, she didn't take responsibility.
We don't manage the 000 system. It's a very complex system.
You still don't know why Optus customers were not able to call 000.
We've done some investigations into that, but we can't investigate that ourselves.
So why don't you take responsibility today and say you will cop a penalty?
We really want this issue to be thoroughly investigated.
Now, as for the question of compensation, well, Optus says around 8,500 customers have been in contact about it, with claims heading towards nearly $500,000. The CEO says the company has paid out about $36,000 so far, but she was unable to clarify whether that was in cash or in free data. Jane?
Fiona, thank you. Four young people have been arrested after an alleged pursuit in Surry Hills in a car police say had been driven from the Sunshine Coast. The vehicle allegedly crashing into around 30 others before coming to a stop.
It's a crazy story, but that's the first time I heard of it. What can you say? I guess they're young kids, and young kids do sort of crazy things.
Police claim the passengers and driver left the scene before jumping into an Uber. Charges are yet to be laid. Two cars have come together in West Ryde in Sydney's northwest overnight, one of them then crashing into a traffic light. Thankfully, though, no one was hurt. A Caringbah man has been sentenced to 5 years in jail for researching pro-Islamic State material on how to make a bomb. A court heard would-be jihadi Daniel Greenfield intended to target police stations. He'll be eligible for parole in September 2025. The New South Wales Rural Fire Service is mourning the loss of one of its own after the death of a volunteer struck by a tree while battling the Hudson Fire near Walgett in the state's northwest. Commissioner Rob Rogers paying his respects to Captain Leo Franson.
Our thoughts are with his wife Margaret and his daughter Julia and son Paul, and also the extended family. It's quite a large extended family, I understand. And this obviously is a significant impact to not only his family, but to the RFS itself. It's a very tight family type unit, the RFS, and these things are incredibly difficult for everybody involved.
That blaze has currently burnt through more than 21,000 hectares and is currently being controlled. Residents in one of Sydney's most exclusive beach spots are having their parking restrictions overhauled. But as reporter Madison Scott explains, the state government is calling on council to go back to the drawing board.
This is just one of the streets in Watson's Bay with exclusive residents-only parking. Since the restriction was deemed illegal, Woollahra Council has been trying to find an alternative to keep both residents and visitors happy. A decision has now been made to allow visitors to park up to 15 minutes in these spots, but the state government has vowed to turn down council's proposal, describing it as speed dating parking that would be impractical and unreasonable.
There's a conga line of people looking for a spot on a sunny day. So the only way to park is actually in a different suburb.
Harriet Price was the only councillor to vote against the change, arguing more time should be given to visitors.
In my view, the practical effect is to leave the resident-only parking in space.
More than 70 of the nearly 1,000 parking spots in the Watson's Bay area are classified as no parking, permit holders accepted. Many of the eligible residents live in heritage-listed weatherboard homes which don't have a garage and can't be modified. They say parking is hard enough as it is, with spaces strictly designated to them, let alone making changes to allow for visitors.
We want people to come, we love them coming, and we love sharing it with people. Why wouldn't we?
A six-month trial of the 15-minute zones was going to be implemented by council over the next few weeks. However, it may be forced to change tack if Transport for New South Wales steps in.
Hundreds of school students protested for action on climate change today, the group gathering at Belmore Park in the CBD before marching with banners and posters to Environment Minister Tanya Plibersek's office. They're demanding the federal government end all approvals and subsidies of new fossil fuel projects.
We are sick of climate inaction, and what we need now is radical, urgent, grassroots, intersectional action and activism that will tackle the climate crisis.
The students were all given pre-signed sick notes to allow them to have the day off school, titled a climate doctor's certificate. Let's have a quick check of the weather now. Right now it is 19 degrees at Sydney Harbour and at the airport, 24 degrees in Penrith. Tomorrow, a partly cloudy day in Brisbane, 26 degrees. Also cloudy here in Sydney and 24. Sunny and 28 in the nation's capital. Clouds will hang about for Melbourne. Hobart can expect a shower or two, warming up to 18 degrees. Adelaide, mostly sunny and 27. Perth, a hot 31 degrees. Sunshine and 34 degrees in Darwin. Newly appointed UK Foreign Secretary David Cameron has travelled to Ukraine, meeting with President Zelensky in his first official working visit to the war-torn country. The visit comes a week after Mr Cameron said he wanted to make Kyiv his first diplomatic destination, assuring them the UK would continue to provide military support however long it takes. New vision has emerged of actor Alec Baldwin handling a prop gun on the set of the Rust movie set just days before a fatal shooting. Take a look.
Hold on. Step back to your original mark. So 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, I'm getting up.
Right.
Then when he drops his arm, Helena, get out. He drops his arm. That means Brady's close. I'm going to start to really get up.
This report now from our US correspondent, Alison Petrowski.
This never-before-seen footage was filmed in the days leading up to Helena Hutchins, the Rust cinematographer, being shot and killed on set. Shot and killed by a gun that Alec Baldwin was holding at the time. These are just some of dozens of scenes provided to special prosecutors just before they announced plans to recharge Baldwin with involuntary manslaughter. In this footage, we see Alec Baldwin rehearsing with prop guns, discussing gun safety, and essentially calling the shots. On a number of occasions, we hear him quite concerned, telling Helena Hutchins where to stand while he's firing.
And everyone doesn't need to be right here, like in the path of the gun. Could you please move?
Just want to be over him a little bit so I can see him.
Now, wait a second. If I'm going to shoot right, you want to go on the other side of the camera? I don't want to shoot toward you.
Now, this will all be evidence presented to a grand jury in New Mexico. That grand jury will decide whether or not Alec Baldwin should go to trial. The grand jury was originally scheduled to meet today. However, the judge has asked for more time to review this new material. But we expect that the grand jury will be called before the trial of Rust armourer Hannah Gutierrez-Reed. Her trial begins in February. Today, Alec Baldwin's lawyers are declining to comment.